morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to worship. I'll call your attention to the announcements that are printed in the bulletin. I will be at Gustavus again tomorrow for the day. We'll be wrapping up our mental health training that has been going on for a few months. The noisy offering today will benefit Lutheran Social Services. There won't be any Sunday school next Sunday or confirmation on Wednesday due to the President's weekend holiday. The Green Lake annual meeting is on Tuesday, February 14th at noon, and we thank our delegates to that from Baxter, Cody Dishaw. Ash Wednesday is February 22nd. Our service times will be 6 p.m. here at Baxter and 7:30 at Sarin. And of course, that service will include the imposition of ashes. Salem is having their annual chili supper on Tuesday, February 23rd from 5 to 7. The Baxter Cemetery Association will hold their annual meeting today following the worship service. We still have some openings on our volunteer sheet for 2023. The biggest need is ushers for June, November, and December. We continue to collect items for Christian Outreach Ministries. February's collection is hygiene items, and there's a donation box in the chapel. If you have any questions about that, just ask Cody Dishaw or any council member. And thank you for your support. It looked like a pretty good load that went over from January. And Cody's been taking those items over to Canby. And then they fill a semi. When they've got a semi load, then they take it to Mexico. So it's quite a ministry. One other thing, I will need help with communion today. Because we switched the date of communion, there's not a communion assistant, so if there's someone who would come up to do that, that would be great. And also to collect the cups, and for collecting the cups, a kid or a grown-up, whatever, whoever can help, that would be great. I believe that's all, unless there's anything else that I've missed that you'd like to bring up. Hearing none, we will begin by responsively reading from the 119th Psalm.
Happy are those whose way is blameless, who walk in the law of the Lord.
Happy are those who keep his decrees, who keep the word of the Lord.
Who also do no wrong, but walk in his ways. Oh, that my ways may be steadfast in keeping your statutes.
And I shall not be put to shame, and where I stay.
I will praise you with an upright heart when I learn your righteous ordinances. I will observe your statutes. Do not utterly forsake me. Our gathering hymn is number 836.
Thank you.
Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God who makes all things new, whose mercy endures forever.
Amen.
Trusting in God's mercy, let us confess our sin before God and one another. God of light, we confess that we have gone astray and have left your light. We follow the shadowy lights of success and fortune. We follow the dim lights that call us to be more religious by following rules. We follow the fading light of personal salvation. Forgive us who are not seeking the true light of your love for all the world. Forgive us for not following the ways of Jesus, who commanded us to love one another. Call us to be light bearers of love, compassion, and justice, in which the mystery of your love is revealed. In the name of Jesus, the Messiah, we pray. Amen. God is gracious and merciful, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love, seating each of us and all creation with the love of Jesus Christ. Amen. Hear the teaching of Christ. A new command I give you, that you love one another as I have loved you. The peace of Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
As God has given us peace through Christ, so let us pass the peace of Christ to each other. Please stand as you're comfortable and greet your neighbor with the sign of Christ's peace. Spooning you baby food because you're not ready to eat real food and you might never be. So we have these two seemingly contradictory ideas. One, we need to make a choice, and two, we're not ready to make that choice. I would like right now for the kids to come up because what I have for the children's sermon is going to take a while, so it'll be going on behind the reader here, so come on up. Boys or girls?
Girls.
Girls?
Boys, who do you think is better at building stuff? Boys or girls? Boys. All right, now, how confident are you that boys are better at building stuff? Are you pretty sure? Kind of sure? Pretty sure? Okay. So here's what we're going to do. We're going to let you three boys be on one team and all these girls be on the other team. All right? And you both have bags with the same stuff in them. Well, one is a horse and one is a goat, but they're the same size, so it doesn't really matter. But I want you to build a little stall for them. You know what a stall is? It's like a place for them to go in and eat their hay without somebody else eating their hay. Do you understand what I want you to do? It won't be really very high, but that's okay. We're imagining, okay? So you know what you need to do? And I want you to work together, okay? So girls, you go on over to this side. You can figure out if you are able to do it. And boys, you go over here. And if you'd rather be on the other side, that's okay too. That's probably a wise choice right there. So at this point, we'll have to remix. You can dump it out or take it out, whatever. Just figure out how you're going to build a stall for those critters. Make the circle big enough so everyone can see. Sorry, go ahead.
First reading is from Deuteronomy chapter 30, verses 15 through 20. See, I have set before you today life and prosperity, death and adversity. If you obey the commandments of the Lord your God that I am commanding you today, by loving the Lord your God, walking in his ways, and observing his commandments, decrees, and ordinances, then you shall live and become numerous. And the Lord your God will bless you in the land that you are entering to possess. But if your heart turns away and you do not hear, but are led astray to bow down to other gods and serve them, I declare to you today that you shall perish. You shall not live long in the land that you are crossing the Jordan to enter and possess. I call heaven and earth to witness against you today that I have set before you life and death, blessings and curses. Choose life so that you and your descendants may live, loving the Lord your God, obeying him, and holding fast to him. For that means life to you and length of days, so that you may live in the land that the Lord swore to give you to your ancestors, to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The second reading is from 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 1 through 9. And so, brothers and sisters, I could not speak to you as spiritual people, but rather as people of the flesh, as infants in Christ. I fed you with milk, not solid food, for you were not ready for solid food. Even now you are still not ready, for you are still of the flesh. For as long as there is jealousy and quarreling among you, are you not of the flesh and behaving according to human inclinations? For when one says, I belong to Paul, and another, I belong to Apollos, are you not merely human? What then is Apollos? What is Paul? Servants through whom you came to believe, as the Lord assigned to each. I planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the growth. So neither the one who plants nor the one who waters is anything, but only God who gives the growth. The one who plants and the one who waters have a common purpose, and each will receive wages according to the labor of each. For we are God's servants, working together. You are God's field, God's building. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand as you're comfortable for the reading of the gospel. Until I finish this reading. It's a pretty long reading though, so don't rush. Alright, this is fun to watch this going on, sorry. The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew. You have heard that it was said to those of ancient times, you shall not murder, and whoever murders shall be liable to judgment. But I say to you that if you are angry with a brother or sister, you will be liable to judgment. And if you insult a brother or sister, you will be liable to the council. And if you say, you fool, you will be liable to the hell of fire. So when you are offering your gift at the altar, if you remember that your brother or sister has something against you,
Leave your gift there before the altar and go. First, be reconciled to your brother or sister, and then come and offer your gift. Come to terms quickly with your accuser while you are on the way to court with him, or your accuser may hand you over to the judge, and the judge to the guard, and you will be thrown into prison. Truly I tell you, you will never get out until you have paid the last penny. You have heard that it was said, do not commit adultery. But I say to you that everyone who looks at a woman with lust has already committed adultery with her in his heart. If your right eye causes you to sin, tear it out and throw it away. It is better for you to lose one of your members than for your whole body to be thrown into hell. And if your right hand causes you to sin, cut it off and throw it away. It is better for you to lose one of your members than for your whole body to go into hell. It was also said, whoever divorces his wife, let him give her a certificate of divorce. But I say to you that anyone who divorces his wife, except on the ground of unchastity, causes her to commit adultery. And whoever marries a divorced woman commits adultery. Again, you have heard that it was said to those of ancient times, you shall not swear falsely, but carry out the vows you have made to the Lord. But I say to you, do not swear at all, either by heaven, for it is the throne of God, or by the earth, for it is his footstool, or by Jerusalem, for it is the city of the great king. And do not swear by your head, for you cannot make one hair white or black. Let your word be yes, yes, or no, no. Anything more than this comes from the evil one. The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. Are we ready? Just about ready? Still working? All right. Oh, you're just about ready. Good. Are you guys ready? Just about ready? Okay. All right. When we're finished, we'll bring them up here. So while we are waiting for the main event here, I just want to say one thing about that list that I just read, that list of sins. I don't see any point in taking them point by point and saying that one, the one about adultery is this, the one about murder is this, the one about divorce is this. I believe Jesus presents the list in its entirety for the same reason that I believe in last week's reading, he said that you would have to be more righteous than even the Pharisees to earn your way to heaven. Jesus is quite simply showing that we can't possibly avoid sin. No matter how darkly we draw the lines, how much we say this is sin and this isn't sin, we can't avoid it. Right? We can't say, I have never thought of someone and said the equivalent of, you fool. And if that gets me cast into hell, well, guess what? I'm done. Right? I have never looked at someone with feelings of lust, ever. This is a list of things that just are. And so we have to ask, what then? Right? Since this is true, that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves, what then? Now, are you done?
Yeah.
Bring it up. Set it right here. Okay? Set it right there. And put the goat or the horse or whatever in it. Wow. Look at this creativity. Yeah. So just a couple of questions for you. How did it go? How did it go? Was it easy or hard?
It kept falling apart.
Kept falling apart? Yeah.
Because they kept moving out.
Yeah, frustrating because
together can be hard, can it? Right? Because you have an idea of what something should look like. And then just a little thing, right? Like taking one block and putting it where another block should be. And see, we're never even done. Right? Now, I'm not going to ask whose is better. Because better is not really a thing when you're building with blocks, is it? Right? I mean, if we don't like it, what do? We tear it apart and start over, right? We aren't exactly building a house here. So I'll explain more what this is about once you guys go sit down. But let's say a quick prayer first, okay? God, thank you for these children, for their ability to work together, for the model that they give us of being able to be frustrated by something without putting it on the other person, without needing to judge. In your name we pray. Amen. Thank you. Now, you go back to your seats, and when the ushers collect the offering, the cans are in the back for you guys, okay? Oh, okay. Sounds good. Go. That's fine. All right. So, this isn't what I expected, which is good, right? If I knew what was going on inside these kids' minds, that'd be odd. They wouldn't be regular kids, would they, if they behaved the way... Although this one is much closer to what I expected. It's a lot like the one that I put together this morning, but it's got some neat features. It's got a little feeder here. The horse was eating out of the feeder. At one point, it had a regular door, but now it looks like it has steps. You know, and it's got some bales on the corner. But this is a pretty sound deal, right? This will work. This would theoretically keep the horses in. It might need to be a little higher, right? Now this one just amazes me. Oh, let's see what happened. I couldn't pick it up. And really, any pen that's designed to hold a goat is doomed. But the difference and the point is this. Everything was identical except the size of this piece. Oh, they lost a piece too. Everything was identical except the one group got this and the other group got this. This thing makes it a lot easier, right? And this is the law. This is the law. God gave the law. Well, let me back up just a little bit and talk about the difference between covenants and the relationship between covenants and commandments. Covenants are relational. The closest thing that I can think of as a covenant is marriage vows. Because marriage vows aren't rules in the sense that they're if-then kind of things. I will love you until and unless. Not a contract like that, like other contracts work. Or I promise that if you do this, I will compensate you thusly. They're a framework, right? Where we say, I will do this. Also knowing that sometimes things aren't going to be perfect. Right? And that we don't have this instant recourse. Well, you did this, now I'm throwing the flag. A marriage is something that needs room to grow. Because we don't know, we couldn't possibly know on the day that we make our vows, what's next. Right? Around us, within us, between us. We continue to grow and change as humans, as do our spouses. Our worlds continue to change. So a marriage vow is a covenant. It says, I love you enough to go on this kind of frightening and exciting journey with you and to work together with you to make something that makes a difference. And that's what a covenant is. And there's all kinds of covenants in the Bible. There's
They usually break them down into five or six main ones, and I won't go into that so much. But the ones that we're concerned with probably are first, the covenant that God made with Noah, signified by the rainbow, where God said, I'm not going to destroy everybody again. I'm done with that. The second one that probably relates to this is the covenant that was made with David. And in that covenant, David was told, if you follow my laws, someday a king will come, because David was thinking of building a temple that ended up being built by Solomon. But he said, don't worry about a temple. If you follow my laws, you're going to have something even better than a temple. A descendant of yours will be the King of Kings. And we know that David didn't hold up his end, and we know that God did, which brings us to the covenant that God made with Moses and the people of Israel that the Ten Commandments are a part of. Moses went up the mountain and received the commandments. The very commandments that he says in today's reading, if you follow these, you will live. And what's the first commandment? I am the Lord your God. You shall have no other gods. And what did Moses find when he got to the foot of the mountain? A golden calf. He didn't even get down the mountain before they broke the covenant. It's like the covenant I have with my dog. You might think that's strange that you would have a covenant with a dog. But my dog, my Great Pyrenees, has this vague understanding that he's responsible for protecting our place and our livestock. That's bred into him. That's his instinct. He knows it. And in turn, my end of the covenant is, as long as you do your job, I will feed you. I will provide you a warm place to go, and I will put up with the fact that the neighbors are tired of you running behind their cars every day. And it's a good covenant, except my dog can't keep it. Part of the covenant is, thou shalt not kill chickens. It's clearly in his job description. He is to care for the livestock, and he knows this. I know that he knows this because every time he kills a chicken, he feels so awful. I mean, he hides them. And then when I find the feathers, he's watching me. And as soon as I find the feathers, he skulks off and hides. And as soon as I take a step toward him, he runs away because he knows that he wasn't supposed to kill those chickens. And he feels awful. And it lasts a little while. And then guess what happens? Another chicken crosses his path and has the audacity to run away, and he chases him down, and he kills another chicken, and he feels terrible, and I get upset, and we go on that way. And that's really the story of the covenant between God and us. Not to cast myself as God, because I do things that God wouldn't do. I use words that God wouldn't use. I throw things that God wouldn't throw. But basically, I tolerate this one area in which my dog is clearly deficient. Because I love my dog. He's a good guy. He always comes to me when I come outside. Even though I can't walk across the yard without almost tripping over him because he loves me so much, I love him for that too. So, this whole idea of covenant, and to go back to covenant and commandments. All right, when God gave the commandments to the people of Israel, I kind of look at them like, not walls, but like boundary lines. You know, here, folks, you're clearly confused about expectations because you keep on screwing up. Let me put some tape down on the floor here so you know when you've crossed that line. And you will cross that line, because they did, right? Again and again and again and again, and we still do. Now let's fast forward just a bit here to what's being talked about by Jesus in the gospel lesson. And when Jesus says, I came not to abolish, but to fulfill the law and the prophets. The prophets, we look at their job a lot of times, like to say, stop it, stop it, stop it, stop it, stop it, stop it, told you so, told you so, told you so, told you so. Stop it, stop it, stop it, stop it, told you so, told you so, told you so. But then we miss this part where there's hope. Jeremiah, in the beautiful passage that I'm not going to read completely, but when he says, the new covenant, where the law will be written in your hearts, and I will be your God, and you will be my people. That vision, that goes way back. That's the prophetic vision regarding the covenant. Someday, you will get it. You won't have to teach each other about it. You won't even have to talk about it. It will be here, where it matters. Now, I see that like this, only a lot bigger, right? We've still got the law, and we can use the law and build on it. When Paul says that you will be like a garden, you will be like a building, we have an idea in our lives of what we're supposed to be building. And we have something that kind of holds it together, and that's law. On the other hand, if we focus exclusively on the keeping of the commandments, if we make the commandments small, and we say, as long as I can stay on this little piece, I'm good. As long as I can live my whole life teetering on one toe on this little thing, I can not only live, I can tell everybody else that they are rotten because they can't stand on my piece of plastic with me. They're exclusive. Right? Only a few blocks will fit on here. And we can see that when we build something on that little bit of law, it can't possibly stand. It can't possibly stand. If we live our lives with the intent of never sinning again, and that's what we base our whole lives on, we're doomed. But if we build our lives knowing that the law is bigger than that, that's the fulfillment of the law. We don't have to go by what you would say the letter of the law. Does it mean we ignore the law? No. The law now becomes not a barrier, but a promise. And think about the difference. If we look at rules as thou shalt not, what's our response when we don't? Shoot, I screwed up again, right? Oh, I'm always screwing up. I am such a screw-up. I hate it. Every time I get scolded. But if we look at the law as a promise of what we will be, a promise, not an ideal pie in the sky, like a real thing, that someday we will live in some sense, probably not this sense, in someday we will exist in a community where nobody lusts after others, where nobody hates others, where nobody even thinks somebody else is a jerk, where we have no anxiety. Oh, a world without anxiety. That's heaven, right? We don't have to worry about what other people might think. That's not something, that's the kingdom. That's what kingdom living is. The law is here to help us. So when we see, instead of seeing every time we stick our toe over the line, we scold ourselves, what if every time we actually get it right? And we do sometimes, right? What if every time we actually love our neighbors, we go, ha, ha, that's cool. Not, oh, I'll never do that again. But if we go, hey, that's neat. That's kind of what it's going to feel like. And we can grab onto that moment. And that's the only kind of rules or laws that can really work. Ones that lift us up, not ones that push us down. Amen. Thank you. So at this point, we will have the installation of officers and councils. So as I read your name, if you would come forward. So today we install Cody Dishaw, Jeff Johnson, Brenda Behrens, Gail Staub, Tara Gottes, Stacy Edvildsen, Jean Mosing, Cindy Jurgensen, Callan Bierkeset, Inez Bierkeset, Dave Kroymans, Dick Erickson, Deb Anderson, Lauren Bierkeset, Judy Eggert, and Jeremy Edvildsen. Dear friends, you have been called by God and chosen by the people of God for leadership in the church. This ministry is a blessing and a serious responsibility. It recognizes your special gifts and calls you to work among us and for us. In love, we thank you for accepting your obligation and challenge you to offer your best to the Lord, to this people, and to our ministry in the world. Live a life in Christ and make him known in your witness and your work. Do you this day acknowledge yourself a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ? If so, respond, I do.
I do.
Will you devote yourself to the service of God in the world? Please respond, I will.
I will.
Will you so live that you enable this church to be a people of love and peace? Will you do all in your power to be responsible to the task for which you have been chosen?
Amen.
Let us pray. Almighty God, pour out your blessings upon these, your servants, who have been given particular ministries in your church. Grant them grace to give themselves wholeheartedly in your service. Keep before them the example of our Lord, who did not think first of himself, but who gave himself for us all. Let them share his ministry and consecration that they may enter into his joy. Guide them in their work, reward their faithfulness, that the knowledge that through them your purposes are accomplished. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. If you just turn and face the congregation, please. Dear friends, rejoice that God provides laborers for the vineyards. Will you do all that you can to assist and encourage them in the responsibilities to which they have been called, giving them your cooperation, your counsel, and your prayers? We will. All right. Thank you. You are now installed. How does it feel? And as we get back, ask everyone to prepare to say the Nicene Creed. Please stand as you're able and join me as we do so. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God,
being
with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets.
We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Let us pray. Truth-telling Savior, you gather your people into one body, gathering us beyond the divisions we create by our fears that it is all up to us to make our lives count. Divisions we create in our anxiety to make the future turn out right. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Crucified and risen Savior, you are among us, offering us your truth that sets us free, and your grace that shapes a good future for all, and your love that fills our lives and lifts us up. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
These gifts draw us ever deeper into your creative presence. These gifts that form us into a people who carry your life-giving future in our world. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Open our eyes to their liberating truth, our hearts to receive them. By your Holy Spirit, form in us a passion for your purposes, a passion that overcomes our self-centeredness, a passion that makes us large in generosity. Hear us, O Lord.
Your mercy is great.
Then grant us your spirit of wisdom, that we may see the work you are doing and may join in with glad and grateful hearts, and be the blessing you have summoned us to be. We ask this in the name of Jesus, whose death and resurrection has made us people of hope. Amen. As you taught us, so we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated as the ushers receive the offering. On the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "This is my body, given for you.
Do this in remembrance of me. After supper, when he had given the cup, when he had given thanks, blessed it, he gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood. It is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you, not only for you, but for all people, for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." You may be seated. Before we come up for communion, I have forgotten to mention, I hadn't even looked at because there's one just like it at Sarah, the railing. And we thank Dave Kreumans for installing the railing here, and hopefully we get good use out of it. Come to the table, for all is ready.
Thank you.
Jesus Christ strengthens us and keeps us in his peace. Short. I can't slide on it. The one time I tried, I almost sent Stacy Haugen sliding across the parking lot. So you take what you can get, you don't throw a fit. But it's a very nice railing and as sturdily built as you expect Sparky to build something. And also, I would like to thank Carla for using the Hymnal Plus. It's nice to have different music from time to time, both because we appreciate the different music and we think about the music that we normally have and appreciate that too. Anyway, receive the benediction. We have celebrated together that Jesus Christ came not only for Christians, but to be known by every person, every country, every culture on earth. For he is the Savior of all. May we come to know him better and then make him known to others, especially by the way we live. And may God Almighty bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Thank you.
So the Cemetery Association meeting will be held right after worship here. So rather than being ushered out, you can stay or go as you please for that. While we've got you here, kids, would you mind grabbing the cans and collecting the noisy offering, please? Thank you. Oh, and go in peace, the peace of Christ, and walk in his light. Thanks be to God.